So are you able to see this interface?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes.
So basically this is lecture number 11. Lecture number 11. And today's lecture basically I am going to talk about sliding mode control design using regular form. And I will define what is meaning of regular form. And you have already understood that what is meaning of sliding mode control. So first I am going to talk about again the region of attraction. Okay, because I found that a lot of students has confusion on this, and due to that reason I am going to repeat that part. So basically let us try to see the formulation. So what basically we are telling that I have system like x1 dot equal to x2 and x2 dot equal to fx plus gx into u. We are assuming that x has two state variables, and after that we are assuming that u belongs to R. Now what we are going to do, that we are going to design some kind of on-off control for this. We are assuming that this fx is uncertain, but obviously that is bounded. Gx is also uncertain, but gx will satisfy this kind of basically inequality, that is always greater than equal to zero. So this kind of assumption we have. And after that, we are also assuming that fx is somehow that is bounded. So you can assume something, some number you can assume. So and these two are a scalar quantity, because x2 is a scalar, due to that region fx is a scalar, gx is a scalar. And what we are going to do, we are going to design somehow on-off control for this. On-off control. And during the on-off control design, we are going to define the manifold that is called sliding mode manifold, that equal to a1 x1 plus x2. And after that, what we are going to tell, that I am going to design control u, that is basically minus somehow, that is constant, some kind of constant gain we are telling, that k dash signum S. So we are going to apply this kind of control where k is some kind of constant, and after that what we are telling, that during design process we have assumption like this, a1 x2 plus hx by gx. Gx is a scalar, so I can write like this. If that is vector, then I cannot able to write p in p by q form. At that time I have to write in g inverse form, and I am assuming that that is bounded by some gain k. And whenever I have this kind of restriction, what we found, that we will get the semi global stabilization. So it means that I can enlarge my region up to infinity also, provided I have some kind of gain that is parameter dependent. Parameter, why that is parameter dependent? You can see that hx and gx is the parameter of the system somehow, and that is uncertain. So if I increase the right hand side part, then I can able to comment that I can start anywhere from this state space, means I have two dimensional state space. So I have x1 and x2, and I have this kind of manifold. So if I have flexibility, that this gain k, this particular gain k, if that is basically extend up to infinity, then I can able to extend this particular region. If that is finite, but we found that I have somehow some region of attraction, and I have plotted region of attraction like this. Please be careful, whenever I am plotting this kind of region of attraction, at that time I have used the infinite norm. If you are going to take two norm, at that time this region is basically become some kind of circular region or some kind of elliptical region also. Because at that time norm is x1 square plus x2 square, something like that. So here I am going to take the infinity norm. And what we have observed that if I have this kind of region, so x1 is less than equal to c by a1, if I remember correctly, and s is less than equal to c, then, and if this gain is bounded, then I can tell that this particular set is positively invariant. Am I right? Sapthik, am I right? Up to here, confusion? Now confusion is that whenever I am trying to calculate this kind of region, so I have proceed like this. Since my system is x1 dot equal to x2, so I am going to write transformation like s minus a1 x1, and after that s dot equal to a1 x1 dot plus x2 dot, and after that I am writing a1 x2 and plus this is hx plus gx into u. So this kind of things I have, and after that, since I know that this particular a1 x1 by hx by gx is bounded by k, so if I select k dash, that is the gain of on off control, if that is greater than k, then I can able to claim that s equal to 0 after some finite time t greater than or equal to t. Anyone has confusion on this? Since I know that from here you can see ax1 plus hx2 is less than equal to kgx. So if I select gain that is little bit higher than this k, k dash is greater than k, so now in this way I can choose k, then I can able to claim that s equal to 0. Once s equal to 0, then I am able to also claim the stability of this particular system. During the calculation of region of attraction, what I have done, I have taken this kind of Lyapunov function, that is v equal to half x1 square. And since this is valid candidate of the Lyapunov function, why? That v equal to 0 only when x1 is 0 and v is always positive. So I am just seeing the reduced order dynamics. I am not concentrating dynamics during the sliding, during the reaching phase, because whenever I have two dimensional system, then basically I have already explained you that I have basically two phase. So I have one phase which is called reaching phase, and this phase is called sliding phase. So based on the dynamics of the sliding phase, I am going to calculate the region of attraction basically. And how to do that? I am going to take the derivative of this, that is x1 dot, and x1, and what is my x1 dot? That is minus a1 x1. Up to here, anyone has confusion? I hope that up to here everything is clear. Now you try to see that now I have something like x1 into s minus a1 x1 square. This kind of things I have. And after that, what I am assuming that my s, suppose I have to put some restriction on s. So I am telling, okay, if s is less than equal to some c, at that time I can able to write v dot less than equal to mod x1 c minus a mod x1 square. Like that I can write. And after that, I am able to write like this minus, and if I will take minus sign, mod x1 is here, then a1 minus, I have a1 mod x1 minus c. And after that, what I am telling, since here I am not doing any manipulation, so equality sign is here. After that, you can see that what I am telling, this should be positive because I have to maintain v dot less than equal to 0. Then only I can tell that if some trajectory will start, then they are going to decay. Or whenever energy v equal to f s 1 half x1 square I have assumed, that is decreasing with respect to time. Due to that reason, this requirement is essential, and for that I have to make sure that x1 should be greater than c by a1. So from here you can see that I have written this kind of things, or equality sign is also okay. But okay, for asymptotic decrement, that I am going to put, I am just going to concentrate with inequality sign. So either you can put here or not put here, that doesn't matter. So now try to understand things like this. What I am telling, that I have some kind of system where I have this kind of structure S, and S I am assuming this as a some kind of disturbance. You can interpret like this. And I am telling that this disturbance is bounded by C. So this kind of assumption I have. Now, is it possible to analyze like this or not? What I am telling, x10 is the equilibrium point. Now, if I have something, that is here I have C by A1 and here minus C by A1. So what happens, that if we are in this region, then what is my behavior? My behavior is like this. If you are inside this particular region, then value of A1 X1 is lesser than S. It means that I will basically diverge like this. Anyone has confusion on this? Anyone?
No, sir.
And if you are outside, then what is your behavior? You are going to converge. Same kind of message basically actually given by this Lyapunov, one can give from the Lyapunov analysis also. If x1 is greater than equal to mod x1 is greater than equal to c by a, then v dot less than 0. So what basically we are telling, that if you are on this side or this side, because mod is there, then you are going to converge towards this. Okay. Now, suppose if you are here, then what is your behavior? First, you will diverge. But once you try to cross this boundary, that is not possible, because v dot is less than equal to 0 outside of this, or strictly less than 0, you can also assume. So now what happens, that this set, what is behavior of this set? Which set is positively invariant now? Subtic
means when outside the boundary of minus c by a1 plus c by a1, it will converge to the set, and when inside the set, that will diverge. So minus c by a1 to plus c by a1 is the positively invariant set.
So which region one can tell positively invariant, outside or inside? Now you can also, what is the definition of positive invariant? If you start inside
we will be there after some time.
You are positive invariant means In all positive time, you are going to stay there. So if you start from anywhere inside this region, so that property
will satisfy. Stay at the boundary, actually.
Not stay at the boundary. Anywhere in between this, I do not know. Trajectory, I do not know, because I am telling that that is basically C is uncertain. Somehow, because whatever bond I am calculating, whatever things I am calculating, so everything is uncertain. So we don't know, but only I can claim that something is going to remain inside C by A1. That much information only I can tell. I do not know where trajectory is going to leave, but somewhere between here, they are going to leave. Because exact things, nothing is exact here. Due to that reason, we are telling that if you start anywhere inside this particular region, so basically this region is positively invariant. This particular region is positively invariant. It means that if you start from this particular set, you are not going to leave this set. It might possible you are at the boundary. But again, if you are at boundary, again repulsive force acts and you are not going to leave this.
Maximum it will be at boundary, not cross the boundary.
Not cross
that means that set is the positively invariant, means in this set it will remain. And from outside it will come to inside that.
If you start anywhere outside, finally you have to converge towards this. Due to that, yes, only this set is invariant. So how to represent that set? I can represent like, because x1 is less than equal to C by A1, and in order to calculate x1, I have already assumed that this is less than C, because this calculation is fully based on assuming that S less than C, we are assuming S as a disturbance. And due to that region, if you see, then I have plotted this region. So this is my sliding surface, and I have taken one norm. How to define one norm? Whenever you are calculating one norm at that time, that is maximum.
X1 plus X2.
So X is X1, X2. This is the vector. And whenever we are calculating, we are telling this is the infinity norm. It means that I have to take max of something. So max of Xi. Anything. Max of I, you can write out this is Xi. And due to that region, whatever region that comes into picture, that is looks like this. Okay, but suppose if you will take two norm at that time, basically my region become little bit different kind of region basically comes into picture. That might be circular x1 dot or elliptical x1 dot is equal to x2, because one student asked me this question that whatever region I have plotted that looks like this, why you have plotted this kind of region? Okay, so that is the answer, because in finite dimensional space, you can define norm by n different way. Okay, and somehow all norms are equivalent, but they are going to cover different area. So it is very easy to visualize. You can take two vector x1 and x2, and after that you can just make this p equal to 1. So after that, you can take one norm, two norm, infinity norm and plot. You are able to see that all norm will contain different area. So in this way, I can able to imagine different region of attraction. So most of time people are taking infinity norm and they are plotting the region of attraction. Now is this become clear to you?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Anyone has confusion on this? Anyone? So things is like this. Most of power system or power electronic systems or some kind of machine like system or mechanical system is basically non-linear. And due to that reason, you have to understood that if you apply sliding mode control to that non-linear system, then basically we will just get some kind of semi-global stabilization. Means we are only able to talk about the convergence inside some specific region only. Because most of time, actuator cannot tolerate any value of gains. That is the restriction. Now, let us try to see one more thing. And actually, it is possible to show that for the same system, suppose I am again going to repeat with the same system, fx plus gx into u. Most of time what happens, this fx is uncertain, but people has always certain kind of knowledge that basically this fx is some value like f0x plus delta fx, something like that. They have certain kind of knowledge that might be plus minus something delta fx. It means that suppose this is mass of some system, then I can assume that whenever I am doing measurement, at that time mass is varying from m minus delta m to m0 minus delta m to m0 plus delta m. Similarly, similar kind of things I can assume for this particular quantity. This is some kind of estimation g0, that is nominal value plus minus certain kind of perturbation, that is zero, like this. So this part is unknown, and only these two parts are unknown. Some nominal value I can always able to assume. Some part of mass is known. We have estimation. And during practical experiment, people are able to understand what is value of F0 and G0. At that time, it is possible to show, again, I can able to now redesign the control like this. What we are telling that since some part is known to me, so whenever we are doing sliding mode control, at that time we are designing the manifold, and based on manifold basically we are calculating the control x1 dot and plus x2 dot. Now you can see here that what I am assuming, that a1 x1 and x2 is, now I have something like, I have some kind of estimation, and estimation I have, first you can write as it is, fx plus gx into u. After that, what you are telling, okay, I have some kind of information like this, that is h0, or I have, perhaps I have written fx plus gx. Okay, so here we have to write fx, because in some slide I have written f, and due to that reason, so f, so then this become f0, that is nominal value, and after that I have delta plus minus delta f0 and plus minus delta f, and after that I have g0x, and after that I have plus minus gx, and multiplied by u. So I have now this kind of a structure. Now you can see that I have at least this part is well known to me, f0 plus g0 and x, and after that u, and after that unknown part is now just this, delta f plus minus delta f plus minus delta z x, here x is also there, and I have u. Now you can see that since I am assuming that both state information is available, so x1 is known to me. This is a1 x1, basically this is x2, x1 dot equal to x2, this is x2. Now I can assume that this is known to me, this is known to me, this is known to me. So everything is known to me. It means that I can able to do some kind of correction during the control formulation. So I can now assume that my control u contain this kind of part, 1 by g0 into x, and g0 is positive obviously, after that a1 x2 minus f0. And I have some kind of term that I am going to design based on sliding mode control. So this is my term. Basically, this term, whatever I am going to design from sliding mode control, this is v. So basically, since f0 is known to me, a1 x2 is known to me, so I can able to give feedback. So if you will give this kind of feedback here, now you can see that your closed loop system is now x dot equal to, you have now v plus, and after that you have plus minus delta fx, and after that you have plus minus delta gx, and again if this u you are going to substitute, again this things comes into picture, g0x, and after that you have minus a1x2 minus f0, and after that you have v. So you have this kind of situation, and in this way I can able to design now this v. And since delta gx is very much small with respect to gx, so in this way it is possible to show that the value of this whole things most of time that is very very small. So now I have to apply very small amount of control, there is no need to apply large amount of control. So if you define this part, this whole part as a some quantity v plus delta x, you can define this whole part. And why I am telling that effect of v, you can see that same v is here, same v is here, still I am assuming that their effect is very very minimal, because here delta g by g0x is comes into picture. So I have mass equal to 200 kg and variation is 5, so 5 by 200 or 2000 is very much minimal. Due to that reason effect of this will not comes into picture. And then by designing some kind of gain that is smaller than the original, initially we are designing like this signum x, and how to design this k dash, we have to make sure that this k dash must be less than, because we are basically designing from this inequality gx plus a1x2 by hx, and after that we are putting this as a k. Now since these things are very much scaled out, due to that reason now if you apply a small gain only, you are able to achieve sliding mode control. So based on a specific problem, now whatever gain basically we are selecting here in first methodology, what we are doing, we are not worrying about any parameters. You can see here that I am assuming everything is uncertain. Even if known part is given to me, hx and gx, we are not using their information. So we are assuming, okay, hx and gx, some part is known, but we are not using their information. Due to that reason, we have to use some kind of higher gain. You can see that k dash. But if you are going to use their information, some part of known information, then it is possible to show that you can able to decrease the amount of control. So control has two part, one known part, another is from the sliding mode control. So these things become clear to everyone or not? Are you able to understand this part or not?
Yes, sir.
So in this way I can redesign. Okay. So because what happens, why we are going to do this, you try to understand one more thing, that whenever we are on sliding surface, this is two dimensional case, and here x1 and here x2, and this is s equal to 0. So once trajectory is converged to the equilibrium point, at that time you can see that control, they start behaving like this, signum s k dash, and k dash here basically switching from minus k to plus k. So if you plot the control, this is my control with respect to time, then what happens that you are able to see this kind of picture. I have already shown you that kind of picture to you. So basically, suppose you have certain kind of mechanical actuator. So this kind of picture basically comes into picture, and everywhere that is blurred in color, and their maximum value is minus k dash, or minimum value is minus k. So they are switching between these two, and this somehow disturbing the actuator, because actuator has to somehow move in this direction, and after that suddenly in this direction. So movement of actuator is very high, and due to that reason you might feel some kind of some kind of effect on the system also. So people are telling that if you are able to reduce this effect, and that kind of wearing and tearing effect on mechanical actuator is called the chattering. So you are able to actually reduce the chattering. Due to that reason, people are trying to select minimal level of gain. In this way, you can also able to save the energy. So that is the motivation. So in this way, you are able to save the bad effect, that is chattering, that is comes into picture due to the sliding mode control. So that is the one of the way. Another way I will discuss in the latter part of this course. Now, today's lecture, I am going to talk about this some more thing that is called regular form. And try to understand the motivation now. Till now, what we are doing? We have seen that suppose if I have system like this, dt, or more generally, if I have system like fx1 or hx1 everywhere I am writing, due to that reason I will maintain that kind of things, hx1 plus gx1 into u, and if x belongs to R, x1 belongs to R, then we know that how to design the control system. Both case I have discussed. After that, what happens? I went to this case, x1 dot equal to x2 and x2 dot equal to u plus dt. Then how to design the control system? Again, I am assuming that dt is bounded, and here basically I have two dimensional space, and everywhere you can see that I am assuming that u belongs to R. I have only one control input, and after that I have to stabilize two states, x1 and x2. After that I have generalized this problem to further level to nonlinear system, x1 dot equal to x2, and after that x2 dot equal to hx plus gx into u. And I am assuming that hx and gx both are nonlinear and both are not well known to me. Again, here I am assuming u belongs to R, x belongs to R2. So this kind of assumption I have. And whenever I have nonlinear system, we are assuming that most of time I am restricting myself. We are assuming that this x is belongs to D and D is subset of R2. So basically we are not covering whole space. We are just covering some part of a space, and this space we are telling D in case of nonlinear system particularly. And everywhere you can see that I am just assuming that I have single input system, but in reality I have sometime multi input system. So one of the goal is to how to generalize this kind of control design for multi input system. I have already told you that in previous class also, in previous lecture, if you have certain kind of chain of integrator form, if you remember correctly, x2 and after that x2 dot equal to x3 and similarly up to xn dot equal to u. This kind of things if you have n plus dt, again this is in chain of integrator form, and dt is some kind of uncertain things, then I have told you that you can design u equal to minus k signum s, and s I can select like this way, xn plus c1 x1 plus c2 x2 up to cn xn. And in this way, if I select k greater than D, and if I select C1, C2, C3, either based on the Newton's way that I will decouple everything, and I am going to make sure that all eigenvalue is negative, then based on that I can design C1, C2 and Cn. Is these things become clear to everyone up to here? What basically I am telling? For third order, yeah. We have already seen that this is x3 plus c1 x1 plus c2 x2, and we know that how to design c1 and c2. Similarly, I can able to generalize up to here. Okay, anyone has confusion on this? Now, similarly, I can extend this result if last state is just non-linear, suppose if last state is like this, that is again in hx and plus gx into u, then again I can select same kind of control u equal to minus k dash signum s, and s remains the same, xn plus c1 x1 plus c1 x1 plus c2 x2, and up to I haven't written in very well form, and this is cn minus 1 xn minus 1, like this c1 x1 c2 x2, so cn minus 1 into xn minus 1, and this is xn. So in this way I can design it, and I have to select this gain k dash, that is like same by this theory hx, and here I have c1 x2 plus c2 x2, c1 x2 plus c2 x3 plus cn minus n xn, and by gx, and I have to bound this whole quantity by k, and after that if I select k greater than k dash, then I am able to give guarantee that if that will means this system. Now I have some kind of n dimensional system, so n dimensional system I cannot plot, so I am telling now since this is nonlinear system, so again I have certain region of attraction, that is D, and if I select this kind of gain, then I can able to get semi-global stabilization. Anyone has confusion in this, why I have written c1 x2 c2 x3 cn minus n xn? Anyone has confusion? What basically we are doing, I am going to do s dot. S dot is xn dot and c1, x1 dot equal to x2, c2 x2 dot equal to x3, and after that whatever things is not known to me, I am going to please go ahead.
K dash greater than k, right?
K dash. Yeah. Sorry. K dash greater than k. Yeah, you are right. Thank you. So if I select k dash greater than k, then I am able to get semi-global stabilization. Again, those parties known, you are able to put here, and again you will get same kind of result. At that time, using some small gain, you are able to achieve same kind of stabilization, semi-global stabilization again. So this form is basically chain of integrator form. So either we have linear chain of integrator form or non-linear chain of integrator form. Okay. But suppose that if I do not have this kind of form, and everywhere you can see that I have only assumed that whatever input that belongs to some kind of a scalar input, you can tell, or belongs to R, real number. So I have just one dimensional system. Anyone has confusion on this? Up to here, anyone has confusion? Why basically I have written this and how basically we are generalizing? If you have confusion, then please let me know. Anyone?
No, sir.
Okay. Then now I am going to talk about some general form. So general form, I am going to talk general form in two way basically. Again, what I am telling, I have some kind of first try to understand theory for linear time invariant system, and after that from linear time invariant system directly I will move to linear nonlinear system. You can also able to extend same theory for linear time varying system, but that is not required, because if you understood for linear system, linear time invariant system, same kind of theory one can extend for nonlinear system. Due to that reason, I have taken this kind of structure now, B into UT. And here you can assume something like again some uncertainty, and I have already told you that sliding mode is only able to handle those kind of uncertainty which is input, which is going to come into picture through the input channel, and due to that reason people are writing like this. It means that whatever uncertainty that is going to input inside the system, that is through the input channel. So this way we are telling B is outside UT plus DT. It means that I am assuming that whatever uncertainty I am considering, that uncertainty is matched uncertainty. Anyone has confusion? Matched uncertainty means those uncertainty which is in direction of control. And whenever I have some uncertainty in direction of control, then I am able to handle it. So now let us try to see that this system is not in chain of integrator form. I have some kind of generalized system, and I am assuming that xt belongs to Rn, ut belongs to Rm. So I have n number of, basically xt belongs to Rn means I have xt that is defined like x1, x2 up to xn, and similarly I have control that is defined like u1 up to um. So this is not basically single input system, this is multi input system. I am not talking about output here, I am assuming that all state is also output. It means that this is somehow multi input multi output system. So first try to understand that if I have single input system but that is not in chain of integrator form, then what is my situation? Or you can directly start from the general system and after that we will come to that. So what I am telling now, that since ut belongs to um, so I have only m number of control input, but I have to handle basically n number of state. So if you remember the second order design, then things become pretty easy. So whenever I have this kind of a structure, how basically we are dealing? We are assuming x2 as a some kind of virtual input. And how basically we are designing that virtual input? So one of the easy way to design virtual input x2 as a, sometime we are assuming that if that is a1 x1, then what happens? I can able to give guarantee that x1 tending towards 0 as t tending towards infinity. And based on this, basically I am designing the sliding surface, and sliding surface S is nothing but combination of these two, A1, X1. And after that we are telling, okay, in finite time, now our aim to make S equal to 0, then automatically this kind of a structure basically comes into picture. So now you can see that I can also able to write this whole things like this, A1, and after that here I have 1, and I will write this as a x1, x2. Anyone has confusion on this? Is it possible to write this particular thing in this form or not? R1 into C1, that is multiplication of
yes,
vector. And after that, now you can see that I am also able to write this A11, and I will, x1, x2 is nothing but x. And due to that reason, people are telling, okay, this particular quantity is not something, some matrix S. So, and sigma is basically A1 and 1. In this way also I can write. Now try to understand the story. What basically we are telling, we are trying to make S equal to 0. And here, in this particular subsystem, you can see that there is no control that is not going to come explicitly come into picture in this particular part, in this first part. Here you can see that if you just concentrate on this subsystem, then there is no explicit component of control that basically present here. So whenever I have this kind of system, and we know that I have just m number of control input, so it means that at least Rn minus m component is not directly affected by control. Have you able to understood this thing or not? Here you can see that I have two dimensional system, so I can assume that only one state is affected by control. So similarly, and other is affected due to the some kind of virtual coupling between these two. So control is not explicitly appear here, but virtually that is also present in form of x2. So now what I am telling here, since dimension of x is basically n and I have m number of control input here. So I am going to convert this system in such a form such that only m number of state of this particular system is going to directly affect by the control. So what basically we are telling that if I will represent this system like this, so I am going to represent now this whole system in this way. I am telling that if I am able to write system like this, I have x dot t equal to axt. I am again going to repeat this part bt and plus dt. And I know that x, this belongs to Rn, this belongs to Rm. Now I am going to apply certain kind of transformation to this particular system, and that transformation I am telling, okay, there exists some kind of transformation Tx here, and using this transformation I have this kind of a structure Z1, Z2, and basically here this Z1 belongs to Rn minus m and Z2 belongs to Rm. Then try to see that what kind of basic structure comes into picture. So if you differentiate this Z dot, it means that this is Z1 dot and this is Z2 dot. And after that, now I am telling that I have T X dot, and X dot is AXT plus BUT plus DT. I have this kind of thing. Now what I am telling that I have this XT and plus B T into B U T plus DT. And we know that whenever I have already told you that whenever you are applying some kind of transformation, then you have to make sure that that transformation should be invertible. Otherwise, you are able to move from X to Z, but you are unable to move back from Z to X. And due to that reason, we are assuming that this transformation T is invertible. Now try to understand the dimension of this transformation. So basically, this is Rn and this is Rn. So what is dimension of this transformation? Anyone? What is dimension?
Rn cross n.
And I am assuming this matrix is constant matrix. That is simplest assumption. And I am assuming that T is invertible. So T is invertible means determinant of T is not equal to 0. Means that is non-singular. Same kind of things. So I am telling that T inverse exists. And if T inverse exists, then in place of XT, I can able to put TA T inverse into ZT, and after that I have TB UT plus DT. So this kind of situation I have. Now you know ZT is nothing but Z1 and Z2. So you can write Z1, Z2 like this. And after that, now you can define transformation in such a way such that you have something like if B, suppose that if you see this matrix, again come back to here. B, you can see that if I try to decompose B like B1, B2, like this, then what happens? B1 belongs to Rn minus m and B2 belongs to Rm. Because I have only m number of control input, due to that reason I am going to decompose this into B1, B2. And suppose that if there exists certain kind of transformation such that this particular quantity is lastly come like 0 or 1 or identity matrix, you can assume, or B2 also you can assume, that doesn't matter, UT plus DT. So if this kind of transformation basically comes into picture, then now try to see the situation. What happens? Now I have z1 dot equal to, and t18 inverse, I am writing like this. I have a11, a12, a21, a22. And basically here, one more step I am going to write, then things become more transparent. And this become z1, z2. And basically, I am assuming that basically after applying t, I have this kind of situation. This is identity matrix and ut plus dt. This kind of situation I have. Now try to see the dimension. What is dimension of this? What kind of dimension I have assumed for z1?
N minus m.
N minus
m. So that is n minus m. For z2, this is m. So what is dimension of this? What is dimension of this? Anyone has confusion? N minus m cross n minus m? Anyone? Because somehow I have to make some kind of relation like this. Z1 dot equal to a11 z1 plus a12 z2 r1 into c1, and after that I have z2 equal to a21 z1. T is everywhere, I am not writing that. A22 z2, and after that I have ut plus dt. Anyone has confusion on this? So basically I am telling now that dimension of this is basically rn minus m, and due to that reason this should be n minus m cross n minus m. What is dimension of this? A12, please tell me.
M cross m.
This is m cross m. And in this way you can see that if I have m number of control, then only m number of state in transform coordinate system is going to affect by that. But I have to make sure that TB should be like this. Or in more general case, I can also, if assume this like this, that is also enough for our purpose. B2, in place of identity matrix, here this matrix is identity matrix and dimension of identity matrix is m cross m. So even if that is 0 b2, that is also okay for me. That is not going to hammer us. So now you can see that basically now only this much number of state is going to be affected by the control input. So suppose for the simplicity purpose, now try to understand, and after that obviously I will move to generalized case, and I will tell you why I am not moving to towards generalized case now. Basically you can see that I have, suppose if I have system like this, x dot equal to axt plus but, and now I am assuming that xt that belongs to rn and ut belongs to rm. Ut belongs to R. Only I have one dimensional control, and suppose dt is here like this. This kind of situation I have. Here you can see that I have one dimensional control, so I can again define some kind of transformation tx, and after that using this transformation I am able to write this as a11 z1 plus a12 z2, and after that z2 dot equal to a22 z1 plus a21 z1 plus a22 z2, and plus if I am assuming that I have after applying TB, if that is identity, then I will get this. Anyone has confusion on this? So could you please now tell me what is dimension of z1 if I am assuming ut belongs to R? R n minus 1. Anyone has confusion on this? And z2 is just belongs to R. This belongs to R. After that, now I am going to design sliding surface like z2 and plus c z1. So could you please now tell me that what is dimension of c? because you know that if I have one control, then whatever dimension of S, that is also unity, because I am writing some kind of linear combination. So this is R, this is R n minus 1. So what is dimension of this?
One cross n minus one.
So in this way I can select this, and after that now you can see that there is no disturbance that is associated with this particular part of the subsystem. Now if you apply this kind of transformation, then try to see that what is my system. My system looks like A11 Z1 plus A12 S minus CZ1, and C I have to design, obviously that is matrix, and after that S dot is Z2 dot plus CZ1 dot, and CZ1 dot you are aware that what is that, and Z2 dot you are knowing that you have this whole things is A21 Z1 plus A22 Z2, and after that you have UT plus DT, and after that you have C, and Z1 is A11 Z1 plus A12 Z2. Now could you please tell me that what is value of control UT? Quickly please tell me what is UT. How to define UT? Anyone? You can tell, I will write. Sapratik?
Yes, sir.
What is value of UT? What is our aim? Our aim to
put S dot equals to minus K of sigma minus plus DT.
Yeah. So finally, then you have to just
minus of A21 Z1, minus of A22 Z2, and
minus of this part.
Minus of C of A1 plus A12 Z2.
So if I design, and after that I have to include one more part, that is K signum S.
K signum, yes.
If I keep K greater than DT, just if this kind of situation I have, then I am able to give guarantee that S equal to 0 in this particular process, S equal to 0. So now what happens? What is my dynamics? Reduced order dynamics, because after finite time, after T greater than equal to T.
One dimensional.
That is not one dimensional. What is dimension? Ruchi, what is dimension of this?
The dimension of
reduced order dynamics. When S equal to 0, then what is our overall dimension of system? Initially, I have n dimensional system.
N minus 1.
N minus 1. Anyone has confusion on this? Because you can see here that Z is R n minus 1 and S is R. So dimension of S is exactly equal to the control dimension. So finally, whenever you are talking about reduced order dynamics, that is less. So suppose you have one control, then reduced order dynamics is just less by one. And in this way, I am able to tell that my reduced order dynamics for all T greater than equal to T can be written like this, A21 and multiplied by C into Z1. Anyone has confusion on this? Now, is it possible to write like this or not? And I have another thing, that S equal to C1 Z1 and plus Z2 equal to 0. So I have this kind of algebraic system. After one sliding will start, and after that I have reduced order system. Now, you can see that what is my problem statement now? I have to design C because C is only in my hand. A11, A12, that is given by this system because that is coming from this transformation of the system parameter. So only one thing in my hand, that is C. So could you please tell me how to design C now?
Anyone? So that the whole matrix is negatively definite.
Yeah. So now here again, you have to, you can take any classical way. But during this, you have to make sure one thing. Because you try to see that somehow this part acts like some kind of control. So you have to make sure that these two pair A11 and A12 should be controllable. Why I am telling this? Because in order to design control system, first you have to make, suppose you have this system. Again, start from the original system, BUT and DT. Suppose you have this system. So control design is possible only when this system is controllable. Controllable means you have to check this matrix B, AB, A square B, and up to AN minus 1 into B. If rank of this particular matrix that is equal to N, rank of this matrix equal to N, then only you are able to show that if you start anywhere, then you are going to converge to the equilibrium point, or you are able to move from one point to another point. That is the meaning of controllability. Now you try to see that same kind of problem here basically comes into picture. So this part remains the same and this is somehow acting like control part. So here basically I have control kind of things that is comes into picture, that is A12, and C I have designed, that is U equal to, suppose if you have this kind of system, so you are designing control like K into X. Some control you are designing. So before designing the control, people are checking the rank of this matrix. And after that, if rank is equal to N, that is dimension of system, then only you are able to design control system. Otherwise, there you are not able to, unable to design control system. So that is notion of controllability. So for time being, just you try to understand like this. Controllability gives the some kind of condition that control design is feasible or not. So if you check this matrix, I am not going to go in deep of this theory. If someone has interest, then I have already recorded lecture on this controllability and observability. Please go through that. Why I have to check this kind of rank. But message is just only like this. Under what condition one can design control? Because you can see that number of control input and number of total state is not exactly equal. Due to that reason, for every system control design is not possible. So on which class of system one can design control, that one can test from this particular rank of this matrix. That is only for linear case. For non-linear case, we have another kind of condition. So anyone has confusion on this? Are you able to understand the message? Message is that if you check the rank of this matrix, then you are able to make sure, you are able to understand that control design in this particular system is feasible or not. Or you are able to place your trajectory anywhere in a state space or not. So similarly, if A11 and A12, similar kind of things. So A12 is acts like now B. So you have to make sure that this kind of things, A12 into A11, A12 a square, A12, that also has rank N minus 1 because now I have reduced order dynamics. And from theory, one can easily show that if AB is controllable, then their subpart, if you express in regular form, then that is controllable. So there is no need to check. So whenever you start control system design for any linear system, first, what you have to check? Anyone? What you have to check before designing the control? Because you are going to design the control. So first you have to check that controlled gain is variable or not.
So
first you have to check that if rank equal to n, n is the number of state, then only you are able to give guarantee that now one can design control, because control design there exist infinite many way to control design. So first you have to make sure that control design is feasible or not. So by checking you can not able to claim, because infinite many way I can design control, but at least this controllability condition gives us necessary condition such that I am able to claim that control design is feasible or not. Now you can design whatever control you want. So now what is my control problem? I know that how to tune K gain of that is greater than D, and I know the control structure also, but I do not know how to design C. So in order to design C, now I have to see this reduced order dynamics, and I have to make sure that is stable, means Z1 tending towards 0. So what you can do, since C in your hand, so again in order to apply Newton's kind of law, whatever I have told, you try to select some kind of diagonal matrix, and by adjusting C you try to place according to that. So that is also possible. So or other way, this problem is called pole placement problem. So you have to select C such that eigenvalue of this whole things that is strictly negative, then I can able to claim Z1 tending towards 0, and Z1 tending towards 0, and S is already 0, due to that reason Z2 is 0. Anyone has confusion on this? Anyone? Are you able to understand this development or not? If you have confusion, then please let me know. You have to select C such that A11 minus A12C, whatever eigenvalue of this, that should be strictly negative. That is only the problem now. But you have to solve one more problem, because you can see that originally I have this particular system, this system. Now question is that how to design T, because based on T only you are able to select A11, A12, A21 and A22. You can see that inside control design that particular term is available. So now another question is that how to select the transformation. So for the selection of transformation, we have two different ways. There are several basically, but one of the simplest way I am going to tell you, that you are able to calculate that transformation using very easy way. So I will take one example, and after that I will demonstrate how to select. So suppose I have very simple system again. Suppose my system is like this, 1, 1, 1, 0, 1, 3, and after that I have here you can assume that, okay, here you can assume you have 1, 0, 1, and after that I have X, and here you have some system like this, 1, minus 1, and after that minus 1 and 0, and I have here U1, U2. So I haven't included any kind of disturbance, because just first we are going to understand the regular form transformation, and you are already aware that if some disturbance that is going to enter with U1 and U2, I am able to reject that. Now here you can see that this matrix is nothing but my A matrix, and this is my B matrix. What is dimension of X? Anyone? What is dimension of X?
3 × 1.
And U is basically 2 × 1. So you can see that in this system, I can assume that if all state is reflected on output, then I have actually multi-input, multi-output system. So I have multi-input, multi-output system, because I have 2 input and 2 output. Now what happens, that in this particular system, if you see if you open this, because XT is nothing but X1, X2 and X3, then you can see that what happens, that u1 and u2, that is only two control input, but that is going to reflect with respect to each and every state. You can see here x1 dot equal to x is x1 plus x2 plus x3, x1 plus x2 plus x3, and after that basically here u2 comes into picture. In this u1 minus u2 comes into picture, here u2 comes into picture. So it looks like that each and every state is affected by the control. But whenever we are designing the sliding mode control, we are going to select the dimension of sliding surface that is exactly same dimension like the control. And due to that reason, we have to select those kind of subsystem after finite time t greater than equal to t0, that basically comes into picture, means that is reduced order system. And due to that reason, now I have to define some kind of transformation. And I have already told you that whenever we are defining transformation, then at that time I have to maintain this kind of things tb. Now since I just want only I have two state, two control, so I want to transform this system like this 0 0 1 0 0 1. Then what happens? If I have TB equal to this, and if you see this system again, original system, and if I apply transformation, then with respect to two state only control is going to appear. So basically, first I have introduced this kind of transformation. That transformation is TX1 equal to Z. And I have to maintain TB equal to like this. Then only I can able to make sure that control is explicitly going to appear with respect to two state. And you can see here that somehow I am become little more optimistic, that I am telling that okay, control is actually one control is going to affect one state, another control is going to affect another state. So that kind of diagonalization I am also going to do. Now try to see that how to select that transformation. So one of the way, that is very easy way, or you can also tell that some kind of hit and trial way. What I am telling, that whenever you have now 3x3 matrix, so first you can write that. So you have x dot, and after that I am giving some name A to this matrix, and AXT I have. So this is not present. Okay, I will write it again, otherwise it become confusing. So x dot, now I have AXT plus BUT. And after that, I am telling that, okay, I am going to do this kind of transformation. And in this particular coordinate frame, we have already seen that I have TB into UT. Now I have to define TB such that this kind of structure basically comes into picture. So try to see the dimension of T. What do you think? What is dimension of T? What is dimension of transformation? Anyone? What is dimension of transformation? This transformation T. Sunidhi, what is dimension of this transformation?
Sir, 3x3.
So I have three cross three. So since this is 3x3, so in order to find transformation, what is way that you can just select some kind of identity matrix that is 3x3 matrix. Okay, so actually in literature various ways are available, but based on my experience, I have actually coined one way. And what I basically am doing, that I am telling, okay, if you multiply with identity matrix, then there is no change, same kind of things happens. So first you can take identity matrix, and now you can adjust identity matrix in such a way such that TB equal to identity. So now you have to write B. So what is your B matrix here? Your B matrix is 0 1 1 minus 1 and minus 1 into 0. Now, what we have to do, you have to adjust this identity matrix, because this B is coming from the system. So you are not able to change this, but you are able to play with this. And what is your objective? Because you are also knowing the end result. You are knowing that your end result is like this. So now, and one more thing you have to become careful. I know that T is invertible. So I have to make sure that T should be invertible. Now I am going to adjust it. So I know that R1 into C1. So suppose if I have this kind of matrix, and if I multiply R1 into C1, then you try to see that R1 into C1, 0, 1 is multiplied with 0, 0 is multiplied with 1, 0 is minus 1. So 0. So okay, this is perfectly okay. So there is no need to make any change. Now I have R1 into C2. Now whenever R1 into C2 comes into picture, at that time, that will going to create some kind of problem. And what kind of problem that is going to create now? You can see here that once that will multiply with R1 into C1, at that time I have 1. So now I have to do adjustment. And during that adjustment, please make sure that basically that finally this will not become alter, because you have to maintain 0. So, and you are knowing that here some term is 0. So you, if you change, do change anywhere here, then that is not going to affect your analysis. But if you are going to do change here, then that is going to, because finally you have to do R1 into C1. So, and what we have observed, that basically here 1 and here I have minus 1. So suppose if I put at this place that is minus 1, and this as a 1, then try to see if I will put minus 1 and 1 by heat and trial. Now I am doing. So now try to see R1 into C1. So this equal to 0. And after that, now R1 into C2. So 1, 1 and minus 1, and actually minus 1 multiplied with minus 1, that become plus 1. So again, I have some kind of problem now. Due to that reason, what I am going to do now, I am going to do some kind of update. And what kind of update do you think? If I will do in first place, then I have 0 and this remains 0. Could you please suggest?
1, 1, 1, 3, 1.
So if you just put 1, 1, 1 here, then you can see that automatically I have this kind. It means that I am able to guess this entry and I am going to make 0, 0. Now, second thing is R1, R2 into C1, and here you have to keep this equal to 1. So try to see a structure that if you are going to multiply this, then that is 1. So that is perfectly fine. But now what happens? Minus 1 comes into picture. So what do you think? How to do adjustment now? Anyone?
First 0 should be 1.
First 0 should be 1. If I will put first 0 equal to 1, so you can see that now I will get this kind of objective. Now try to see the last one. So here you can see that R1 into C1. So basically minus 1 is there. So what kind of adjustment I have to do? Anyone?
0, 2, 1.
0.
2.
2, if you multiply with 2 and 0.
Oh, sorry. No.
So you have to
plus, become, plus one.
Plus 1, this is plus 1. Okay, I will place this as a plus 1.
No. 0 plus 1 plus 1.
0 plus 1 plus 1. Okay. So if you will do, please check it. And after that, if this is non-singular, so you have to check after that is non-singular or not. So if that is not non-singular, then again you have to do some kind of deviation on this. And in this way, you are able to define transformation. So only this is the tricky part. So in this way, you will get T. And once you will get T and T inverse, then is it possible to get this or not? That is A11, A12. A21, A22. Is it possible to get or not? Because you know this is invertible. So you are going to fix everything and after that you can guess A12. Try to see the dimension of A12, that is n minus 1. So you have to select like that. Similarly, you can select
A12 inside. 0 minus 1 minus 1 should put.
0 minus 1. Okay, so now at least you are able to understand how basically one can do it. So this is the manual formula or manual adjustment. I will now going to give you the very, very easy way that is basically given by one of the professor, that is Professor Utkin, based off my knowledge. Perhaps Utkin has coined that. So what he is telling, that suppose this matrix B is B1 and B2. And suppose this is Rn minus m and this is Rm. After that, what he is telling, that transformation you can directly able to define like this. In minus m, I is identity matrix. After that, minus B1, B2 inverse. Here 0 and B2 inverse. Okay, so this transformation is automatically make. Now try to check R1, because I have to, what is my goal? I have to make TB equal to identity matrix. That is my goal, 0 into identity. And this I is M cross M matrix. And this is basically N minus M cross N minus M. This is N minus M cross 1 matrix, sorry, not M matrix. So this is, because I am talking about identity, so this is M. Okay. Now you try to see that if you multiply T. So here R1 and B, I have R1 into C1. So B1 comes into picture and B2. So B2 multiply with B2 inverse, then that is identity, or B1 and B2 equal to 0. And after that, that is identity. So in this way also, you are able to make this kind of transformation. So this is the formula. But suppose somewhere if you forget the formula, then by manual adjustment, you can do and able to design what is the transformation. Anyone has confusion on this? Anyone? Now, if you see the literature, then people are also trying to develop this kind of transformation using QR factorization. So what you can do, please go to textbook and try to search that what is meaning of QR transformation or matrix decomposition, this kind of things. One more important thing I am going to share today. Now, if you will read book, then you are able to understand. So I will send you the two books. One very classical book that is written by Sarah Aspergian, Professor Sarah Aspergian. Second book is written by Professor Utkin. Professor Utkin is basically almost the father of sliding mode control, you can tell. And after that, third book that is written by little bit, that is advanced version, that is written by four professor, Professor Levant, Professor Friedman, and Professor Edward. So I am going to share these three books. Okay, but most classical book is book written by Sarah Aspergian. But everywhere they are just going to concentrate on linear system. But in this course, I am also going to talk about nonlinear system, means how to design sliding mode control for nonlinear system. So for that, you have to follow this lecture only. Linear system, for linear system, in every book you are able to see. So for nonlinear system, if you go through the book of Khalil, then some part is basically covered there. Some part, not all. Okay. So up to here, anyone has confusion? So what basically I am telling, that if you have some kind of linear time invariant system, you have LTI system, then it is possible to show that LTI system can be written like this. a11 z1 a12 z2 z2 dot equal to a2 21 z1 plus a22 z2 plus ut, and if suppose you have dt. Now once this kind of form after transformation, we know how to define transformation, then I can design sliding surface again like this, c z1 plus z2. Now here I am intentionally assuming that ut belongs to R. In next lecture, tomorrow lecture, I am going to see that if ut doesn't belong to R, then how first one can develop theory such that in finite time I will get s equal to 0. And that is somehow, that approach is called unit vector control. So I am going to basically talk about that. And because most of realistic problem we have more than one input, and for that, that particular theory is important. So I am going to talk about unit vector control, and actually for nonlinear system, we have to understand what is meaning of feedback linearization. Then only we are able to understand this kind of regular form kind of things. So if you understood the basically regular form, then you are able to understand, if you are able to understand the basically the feedback linearization, then you are able to understand why basically this kind of structure comes into picture for nonlinear case. So I will teach that part also. So feedback linearization I will start, and finally I will come to the how to design sliding mode control for nonlinear system. So up to here, anyone has confusion? So a story is very simple. You have to do transformation such that if you have, suppose you have n number of system and m number of control, so m number of states should be affected by the control, and remaining n minus m, that basically is not directly affected by control. Now whatever variable which is actually making the bridge between these two subsystem, you have to form the sliding surface with respect to that variable, and after that you have to design again sliding mode control. So for a scalar case, when control is a scalar, only one dimensional, then we have seen, in next class we will see that how to design control when we have vector case. Means I have control, whatever example I have taken here, you can see that in this example I have two control input. So using whatever things we have learned till now, it is not possible to design. So we have to extend that theory from a scalar case to multivariable case, a scalar control to multivariable control, you can tell also. So do you have any confusion? Anyone? Okay, so if you do not have any confusion, then I am going to close the today's lecture. Okay, so thank you very much again.